com.
محمد رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام.
كثيرا إلى يوم الدين أما بعد. اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا. اللهم إنا نعوذ بك من علم لا ينفع ومن قلب لا يخشع ومن نفس لا تشبع ومن عين لا تدمع ومن بطن لا يشبع ومن دعاء لا يسمع. ربي يسر ولا تعسر وتمم بالخير وبك نستعين. ربي اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. ثم أما بعد. Respected elders and brothers and those listening at home, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We first and foremost thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for the opportunity of witnessing yet another Jumu'ah. Indeed, as I've mentioned before in previous lectures, the day of Jumu'ah is the day of Eid that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed the Muslim Ummah with during their week. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blessed the Muslim Ummah with two Eids during the year. But in regards to the week of a Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the day of Jumu'ah the day of Eid for them. In an authentic hadith narrated by Abu Hurairah radiallahu anhu, which we find in Sahih Muslim, he says that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, أَفْضَلُ يَوْمٍ طَلَعَتْ عَلَيْهِ الشَّمْسُ يَوْمَ الْجُمُعَةِ فِيهِ خُلِقَ آدَمْ وَفِيهِ أُدْخِلَ الْجَنَّةِ وَفِيهِ أُخْرِجَ مِنْهَا وَلَا تَقُومُ السَّاعَةِ إِلَّا فِي يَوْمِ الْجُمُعَةِ. That the best day upon which the sun rises is the day of Jumu'ah. On that day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. And on that day, Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal entered Adam alayhi salatu wa salam into Jannah. And on that very same day, Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal took Adam alayhi salatu wa salam out of Jannah. And then he completed the hadith by saying that the coming of the hour will not happen except on the day of Jumu'ah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. In regards to the topic for today, obviously it's written on the board downstairs that the topic will be understanding in deen. I was deciding throughout the days coming up to today what to actually speak upon. But after hearing the Jumu'ah khutbah today by Maulana Sindhi, he mentioned a very important hadith. He mentioned the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, which many of us who read a basic book of hadith known as Arba'in al-Nawawi would actually find inside. It is the hadith whereby Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that ad-deen an-nasiha, that your religion, your deen is a genuine feeling for one another. It is sincerity in worship towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now obviously Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was blessed with the very beautiful aspect of jawami'ul kalim. Jawami'ul kalim means that he had the ability to speak in a few words what would have a very great meaning. For example, this particular hadith, he just said ad-deenu an-nasiha, but the ulama have written books and books just explaining these two words, ad-deen an-nasiha. Now those who are understanding the Arabic language would understand why we would derive several meanings from this particular hadith, because of the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam has worded it. Without tiring one and all with the basic details of the Arabic language, the Arabic language teaches us that if two nouns come together in a sentence and both nouns have the definite article, in the Arabic language the definite article would be alif and lam, al. In the English language it would be equivalent to the. So if two nouns come together and both nouns have the definite article, the meaning becomes more expressive. So a normal meaning which would be derived from ad-deenu an-nasiha would probably be that deen is a genuine feeling for one another, or your deen is sincerity in worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But by the alif and lam existing before the two nouns, the meaning changes and we get the English interpretation of there is nothing in your deen except that it is a genuine feeling for one another. So now when you have a genuine feeling for one another, what happens? You advise sincerely. Today, respected elders and brothers, I hope to, inshaAllah, in the short time that I've been given, advise sincerely towards aspects taught to us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The first advice for this evening, respected elders and brothers, that I invite one and all to and advise to is the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal, in many places of his book, very eloquently asks the believing men and women to fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ.
That, O you who believe, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way he should be feared. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way he should be feared. Now, the ulama of tafsir have taught us that when reading the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when reading the Quran, the book of a Muslim, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala uses different context in addressing the people. So sometimes he says, Ya ayyuhan nas, O mankind. And sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, as we've seen in this ayah, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe. Now the difference in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, O mankind, and saying, O you who believe, is that when a believer, a Muslim, the one who has accepted the prophecy of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he reads an ayah in the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu, O you who believe. Know and understand that your creator Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is addressing you, O Muslim, directly. He's not talking to anybody else except you, O acceptor of the prophecy of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And what does Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advise the Muslim ummah here? He says, اتقوا الله حق تقاتي. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala the way he should be feared. A Muslim, respected elders and brothers, my dear mothers and sisters, those who are at home, needs to constantly live their life reflecting upon themselves, making sure that they are constantly abiding to the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Remember, الدُّنْيَا سِجْنُ الْمُسْلِمِ. The world is a prison of a believer, وَجَنَّةُ الْكَافِرِ. And it's a paradise for a disbeliever. We as Muslims, respected elders and brothers, live in this world governed by a constitution. We are not free to do what we want. There are certain foods which we can eat, and there are certain foods which we can't eat. There are certain things which we are allowed to do, and there are certain things which we are not allowed to do. In Jannah, there are no restrictions. There is no restriction upon the son of Adam, upon the servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The reason why we have restrictions here, respected elders and brothers, is because this world is a test. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala leaves us here for a period of time, a period of 60 years, as taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that the average age of the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam will be 60. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question us for each minute of the 60 years that we have spent. Each dime that we have spent. Why? Because this is the place of examination. This is the place of testing. This is the agricultural field where we plant our seeds, we provide the fertilizer, we provide the necessary ingredients, the potassiums, etc., as we learnt in science, and then we reap the rewards in the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from the people of Jannah. So, respected elders and brothers, here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala advises his servant to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's fear. A Muslim who constantly fears Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly revises himself. Before he does anything, before he speaks, before he thinks, he asks himself a question. That this thing I'm about to do, is it beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? If it's beloved, I will continue with it. If it's not beloved, I will refrain from it. By doing this, one is constantly allowing himself to be in the obedience of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why? Because he's constantly remembering Allah, and thus he is fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first advice for this evening, respected elders and brothers, is the advice to the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from all those who constantly fear him. Just as a point of note, since we're discussing the aspect of taqwa, obviously the ulama of tafsir have varied in the exact meaning of at-taqwa. The general translation is the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But an interesting translation comes to mind, or an explanation, that of Hafidh Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani, who was a very famous scholar of hadith. In fact, he has done the commentary of Sahih al-Bukhari, known as Fath al-Bari. He says that at-taqwa is the aspect of placing between you and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a barrier. The aspect of placing between you and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala a barrier. How? By doing that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has commanded, and by staying away from that which Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal has asked us to stay away from. So, by doing this, we automatically remember Allah and thus fear Him. And this is a very, very interesting explanation and a very, very conforming one. As a Muslim who fears Allah indeed places a barrier between himself and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal protect us all. The second advice, respected elders and brothers, for this evening is to the remembrance of Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala once again in His book addresses you and I as the servants of Allah, as the acceptors of the message of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal says,
يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اُذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ ذِكْرًا كَثِيرًا.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, O you who believe, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. O you who believe, remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala doesn't stop there. What does He do? He places an adjective next to what He's asking us to do. He describes how we should actually remember Him. He says, اذكروا الله ذكرا كثيرا. Remember Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal excessively. Remember Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal excessively. So how do we remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Through the various tasbihat taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and through the various azkar, dua taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, through our five times daily salawat. But also in the same way that I spoke about when discussing at-taqwa. You remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala before you do anything. That this thing that I'm about to do, is it beloved to Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal? If it is, I will continue with it. If it's not, I will refrain from it. Remember, O servant of Allah, O child of Adam, you are not a slave of your desires. You are a slave of Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. Before you do anything, it doesn't matter what you want. What matters is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants. So may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who constantly remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The third advice for this evening, respected elders and brothers, that I advise and invite one and all to, is towards the enjoining of good and the preventing from evil. Know and understand, O servant of Allah, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has placed the responsibility of inviting towards good and preventing from evil upon the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala very clearly in His book speaks to the Muslim ummah and says in the fourth juz,
وَلْتَكُمْ مِنْكُمْ أُمَّةٌ يَدْعُونَ إِلَى الْخَيْرِ وَيَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَيَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ.
Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that let there be from amongst you a group that engaged in inviting towards good and preventing from evil. Respected elders and brothers, know and understand that on the day of Qiyamah, we will stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our Christian neighbor, or our neighbor who doesn't believe in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will tell Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that I had this Muslim, this believer in you staying next door to me. Or I had business dealings with this Muslim or this servant of yours, but not once did he ever invite me towards the deen of, or the deen that is accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is Islam. It is a great responsibility placed upon the ummah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If we fear that we don't have the ability to speak directly to one and all, then engage in the other means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has provided, such as the internet, such as email, such as handing out pamphlets, handing out little papers inviting towards the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, papers clearing the misconceptions of Islam. Many of us work in professional environments. Obviously, I am here now addressing the secular public of the community. There's very few of us who are engaged in Islamic studies. Obviously, the majority of the students are from the secular public. We need to engage in inviting towards good, preventing from evil. This was the responsibility of the Anbiya alayhi salatu was salam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Khatam al-Nabiyyin, the seal of all prophets. After him, no other prophet will come. So this responsibility has been given upon us, has been given to us and unto us. Know and understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared this ummah the best of all nations. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has declared this ummah the best of all nations. Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal says that you, O servants of Allah, O acceptors of the prophecy of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, are the best of all nations. Why? Because you have been given the responsibility that was given towards the Anbiya alayhi salatu wa salam. Now, many of us take this lightly and feel that, you know what, we don't have the necessary knowledge in inviting towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, that's true. Those who have the necessary knowledge will specialize in it. But those who don't, it's still upon you, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَةً, that say or teach something from me, even if it's one small thing. Even if it's one small thing. As believers, first and foremost, we know that there is no one worthy of worship except one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is his final messenger. Even if it means us teaching that, it is a responsibility upon us. We need to make sure that we constantly remember this. We are not here just as people who will not return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or as people who will not be answerable to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the necessary knowledge insha'Allah, and we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the ability towards inviting to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next advice for this evening, respected elders and brothers, is towards ilm, towards sound Islamic knowledge. Know and understand, O servant of Allah, that Islam is a religion which encourages, preaches, teaches, explains the importance of knowledge. Today we find many people from the different faculties of life trying to make Islam seem like a religion that is backwards, like a religion that does not have education in it, like a religion that does not encourage education. Know and understand, O servant of Allah, Islam encourages both secular and Islamic education. Both secular, which is your medicine, engineering, accounting, law, etc. Islam encourages both secular and Islamic education. Now, the ulama have divided the aspect of knowledge into two categories. The first category is obviously Islamic knowledge, which is foundational knowledge, which is more comprehensive knowledge. And the second part is secular knowledge. Today, I want to concentrate on the aspect of Islamic education for reasons which I'll mention to you just now. This is not by any means a lecture. It would be more a participation. I'm here speaking to you heart to heart. I'm only going to speak to you once, and thus regarded a topic of advice as an appropriate topic. Respected elders and brothers, today we find ourselves as parents falling into the trap of making sure our children have the ability to master every faculty of life. When it comes to the secular education, we are prompt with it. We make sure we visit the schools. We make sure we visit their teachers. We find out what the difficulties that this child or the student is facing. And if necessary, we will pay extra money in getting an extra tutor to come and provide extra lessons at home. We are making our children from amongst those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in the Quran, يَعْلَمُونَ
ظاهرا من الحياة الدنيا وهم عن الآخرة غافلون.
And this is the beauty of Islam. It is complete. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala deals with this group of people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says that they know everything in regards to this world. But when it comes to Allah and Jannah and the grave and the Akhirah, they are ignorant. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. I am not here by any means, respected elders and brothers and those listening at home, belittling secular education. I am from amongst those who constantly preach the importance of education. And my message to all the youth is that don't become doctors, don't become lawyers, don't become engineers. Be the best doctor, be the best lawyer, and be the best engineer, because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the best prophet that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to us. So don't just stop, don't set your goals at achieving your degree. Be the best you can be in your field, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, when it came to us, He sent us the best prophet in Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He sent us the best book in the Quran. He sent us the best deen in Islam. La ilaha illallah. So my message here is not to belittle secular education. However, we need to understand the importance of striking a balance when teaching and bringing up our children, respected elders and brothers. We find that today we are gaining doctors at the expense of Muslims. We are gaining lawyers at the expense of Muslims. So we had a Muslim child entering university, he came out a doctor and we lost a Muslim. He came out a lawyer and we lost a Muslim. We are losing our children. Why? Because when they get into the universities, etc., they are dealing with different faculties of life, they are dealing with new experiences which we as parents haven't taught them or instilled in them to deal with when they get to that age. Respected elders and brothers, know and understand that Islam is foundational knowledge. Islam is foundational knowledge. It is a way of life. Islam will teach your child who is a doctor how to conduct himself appropriately as a doctor. Islam will teach your child who is a lawyer how to conduct himself appropriately as a lawyer. I can start a topic now discussing the sciences of the Quran, whereby Western scientists have come up with findings that the Quran has spoken about 1400 years ago. When it comes to Islam, we are way ahead. We are not backwards. We need to understand that we need doctors, lawyers, etc. But we need to build them up understanding the difference between the two faculties of life. We need to bring them up understanding how to strike a balance between the two faculties of life. The dunya degree will only take them to the grave, respected elders and brothers. The dunya degree is only going to take them to the grave once they die, once Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sends the angel of death to remove the soul, that certificate expires, it can never be used again. In front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of Qiyamah, it will never have weight. What has weight is how he conducted himself, if he conducted himself appropriately. So we need to understand, respected elders and brothers, the deen of Islam. It is a religion that teaches knowledge. The first words that were revealed to Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was Iqra, which means read. How do we educate ourselves? Through reading. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the first revelation commands Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to be educated by saying Iqra bismi rabbika alladhi khalaq. Read in the name of your Rabb who created you. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made the tool of Islam, the utensil of Islam, the pen. And what is the pen used for? For education. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, الَّذِي عَلَّمَ بِالْقَلَمِ, the one who taught with the pen. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in another part of the Quran, نُون وَالْقَلَمِ وَمَا يَسْطُرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions the pen. So Islam is a religion of education. But we need to understand as parents the importance of striking a balance between the two faculties of education. Make sure that your child, when he enters university, enters a Muslim, and when he comes out a Muslim. And remember my words to you, respected elders and brothers, I'm not here belittling secular education. Myself, before going into Islamic studies, I engaged in secular education. I entered the IT field and studied secular education. The Islam encourages secular education. We need Muslims doctors, we need Muslim pharmacists, we need Muslim lawyers, we need Muslim engineers. And remember what I said, don't just stop there. Be the best you can be in your field. Encourage your children to be the best they can be in their field. Why? because Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was the best prophet. But make sure that they come out of university better Muslims than they were when they went in. And not children who are free from Iman and free from Islam. Today, unfortunately, and I've dealt with this personally through my visits in South Africa, Malawi, and various different countries, children in the universities who are Muslims are questioning their deen. Why? Because they are mixing with atheists, they are mixing with the Christian missionaries who are well educated and are posing them questions which they don't have answers to. So what happens? They start doubting their deen. And we as Muslims shouldn't only send our children to the Darul Ulooms to become ulama when we find them failing in school. This is another weakness of the ummah. We choose to send in the path of Allah those who we find weak in regards to the secular education. They're failing in school, so what we say, send them to the Darul Ulum, let him become a Mawlana. I'm not by any means putting down what our Darul Ulums are doing. They're doing very good work, but respected elders and brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala does not want rejects. Send the best, choose the peak of your children to come and study the deen. Don't send him after he's having difficulties in his secular field. Teach them the importance of striking the balance in both faculties of education. So respected elders and brothers, that advice for this evening is towards ilm. Know and understand that Islam is a deen of education. If anybody tells you otherwise, today you have heard ayat from the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the Quran, proving that Islam is a deen of education in every faculty of life. The next advice, respected elders and brothers, that I invite one and all to, is towards good character. Unfortunately, today we live in environments that teach us character which does not conform to the character taught to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We find children who are extremely vulgar, both in speech and both in action. We find them, I mean, just today I was coming out of the masjid from after the Jumu'ah prayer, and I said salam to somebody. I made the salam. So somebody who was with me said, how do you know that person? Because obviously they were of the thought that you only greet those who you know. You only greet those that you know. If somebody greets you, it means he knows you. Otherwise we don't greet, respected elders and brothers. Islam teaches the greeting in every faculty, in every facet of life. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, afshu salam, spread the salam. It is from good character to make dua for your Muslim brother by greeting him by saying, assalamu alaykum. Since we're speaking about salam, let us take a lesson from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam regarding the greeting in Islam. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us that if a Muslim, excuse me, if a Muslim greets his Muslim brother and he says, assalamu alaykum, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will automatically reward this Muslim who is greeting tenfold. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will automatically reward this Muslim tenfold. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam teaches us that if he says assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will automatically reward this greeter, this Muslim slave of his who is greeting, 20-fold. And if he says assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, which is the complete greeting, Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal will reward the slave of his 30-fold. La ilaha illallah. Free rewards, respected elders and brothers, just in providing a greeting, a dua to your Muslim brother. In the dua, what are we doing? We're saying, assalamu alaykum, peace be upon you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you from his anger. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you from all evil and all harm. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect you from the fire of Jahannam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us all. So that is in regards to the greeting. In regards to the reply, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in his book, which again shows the completeness of Islam, says, وَإِذَا حُيِّيتُم بِتَحِيَّةٍ فَحَيُّوا بِأَحْسَنَ مِنْهَا أَوْ رُدُّوهَا. That if you are greeted with a greeting, then make sure that your response to the greeting is equal to the greeting that you received, or even greater. Listen to this. This is from the completeness of Islam. Islam is a way of life. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala commands us here by saying that if you are greeted, make sure you reply. At least you should reply. And it's better if you increase on the reply. So what are we being taught over here? We are being taught that if a Muslim greets us and he says assalamu alaikum, at that moment it becomes wajib to say wa alaikum salam. But it's better to say wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah, and it's even better for you to reply by saying wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Then if our Muslim brother greets us by saying assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, it is not enough for us to just reply by saying wa alaikum salam. Why? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that the reply should be equal, isn't it? If not better, then it should at least be equal. So an appropriate reply would be wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. And if our Muslim brother says assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, then it is incumbent upon us excuse me, got the hay fever. That's what happens when we come to the UK in the summertime. Thanks. It becomes incumbent upon us to reply by saying wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. So I hope we got that. The greeting is sunnah. The reply is wajib. If someone says assalamu alaikum, it's wajib to say wa alaikum salam. If someone says assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah, it's wajib to say wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullah. If someone says assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh, it's wajib to say wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This again is the beautiful teaching of Islam, a way of life, teaching love for one another. This is in the greeting, automatically we are diffusing enmity that one may have for his fellow Muslim brother. We are diffusing enmity that one may have for our fellow Muslim brother. I didn't plan to talk about it, but even today we find families who are conniving at each other's throats. Blood is thicker than water, but today we find water thicker than blood. For financial purposes, inheritance issues. Just in London the other day, I was faced with an inheritance issue and I was surprised at the connivingness of brothers and sisters at the throats of one another for a gain of a little bit of the dunya. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said that we honored the son of Adam. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَنِي آدَمَ. We have indeed honored the son of Adam. And today we are honoring other things other than the son of Adam. We are honoring money, we are honoring status, we are honoring position over our brother, whether he's our Muslim brother or our real brother. And this indeed saddens the heart, respected elders and brothers. This is not from the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We claim to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but when it comes to following him, we are doing other things. True love comes in following Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We had the unfortunate incident of the cartoon pictures that were printed in the media a few months ago. And the whole Muslim world got up. And they were all in anger, dealing with the problem. And obviously no one will say we don't love the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but respected elders and brothers, a simple question. If you love somebody, you follow him. Today we are bringing up our children in ways taught to us by the West, not by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, yet we claim to love him. We're bringing up our children in a manner that suits us, and that benefits us in this world, and not through the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, yet we claim to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We live our lives daily in our dealings, in our business, according to how we want, according to what profits us, not according to the teachings of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We have feuds, petty feuds. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, bury it, agree to disagree. He teaches us to become united. Yet we become disunited and we still claim to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Our parents, a'udhu billah, who brought us up when we were young. Our mothers. And just the other day I was reading a very beautiful article of a mother who is writing a letter to her child, and she says, oh my child, a long time ago I received the best news of my life. And that was the day when the doctor told me that I was carrying you. Look at the mother, what she's saying. And the days went by, you increased in weight, you increased in size, I suffered various pains, the pains got bigger and more unbearable, it got to a stage where I couldn't breathe, it got to a stage where I had to sleep on my back, I couldn't sleep on my side, so that I wouldn't harm you. I had to watch what I ate
And she's explaining the difficulties she went through. And then she says, but all that only increased my love for you. All that only increased my want to see you. La ilaha illallah. This is a mother, respected elders and brothers. Today, we go against the teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in our mothers. Here in the UK, various issues, I've been here maybe 2 weeks, and various cases already where we're finding children who are more happy to place their parents in homes. A'udhu billah. After all that they've done for us, we feel it appropriate to send them away. We feel it appropriate that they're far away from us. These are times when we need to serve them. Jibreel alayhi salatu wasalam tells Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, curse be upon the one who grows up to see one or both of his parents alive and doesn't do justice to those parents and find himself going into the hellfire. It is a chance for us, respected elders and brothers, to earn our Jannah. Know and understand that after the belief in one Allah, after negating all other deities, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala teaches us, وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ إِحْسَانًا. And be dutiful to your parents. So again, we claim to love Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but when it comes to our parents here, we are going against it. Respected elders and brothers, let us fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next topic I wish to invite and advise one and all to this evening is another hot topic which I definitely feel the importance of speaking about, especially after the various visits that we've had to various schools, various universities, various prisons, is to solid and sound Islamic principles in nurturing. Listen to the heading that I've put to this, respected elders and brothers. Solid and sound Islamic principles in nurturing. Now, what I'm going to do here now is divide the topic into two parts. One part is the nurturing aspect that happens between a husband and a wife. And mashallah, Mawlana Sindhi spoke about it very beautifully today in the Jum'ah lecture. The next aspect is the nurturing aspect that exists between a father, a mother, and their children. Respected elders and brothers, respected servants of Allah, O children of Adam, we are losing our youth on a daily basis to the avenue of drugs. We are losing our youth on a daily basis to the avenue of immoral behavior. We are losing our youth on a daily basis to the enemies of Islam. Know and understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed a serious responsibility upon you as a father, as a mother, when He said, Ya ayyuhalladhina, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu. He speaks to the believers again. Qu anfusakum wa ahlikum nara. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, subhanallah, addresses the believers again and says, protect yourselves and your families from the fire. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala here, O father, O mother, has placed a lot of responsibility on your title. Don't feel for one moment that the word mother and the word father comes cheaply. It comes with great responsibility. In this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has placed great responsibility in these two terms. Then Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam also said, كُلُّكُمْ رَاعٍ وَكُلُّكُمْ مَسْؤُولٌ عَنْ رَأِيَّتِهِ. That all of you are shepherds, and all of you are responsible for your flock. Respected elders and brothers, if we sit and look at ourselves critically today, how many of us are actually doing justice to the word mother and father? Father, how many of us are actually doing justice to the responsibility placed to us by Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? Today we find parents with a very negligent attitude in regards to their children. We find parents who want their children to be free, because when they get married they'll be contained. Look at this behavior and this attitude and this understanding. We find parents who prefer to let their children be brought up from people outside the home. And I always mention this, that a child's mind is like this cup of water over here. A child's mind is like a cup of water that I have in my hand over here. The glass right now is filled with water. Okay. It's okay. Jazakallah. That was an interval break. The glass right now is filled with water. Science tells us that the glass is filled with a compound, H2O. Two hydrogen molecules and one oxygen molecule, as we all learned when we did science in school. When we empty this glass, if I drink all the water up, when we empty the glass, is the glass full or is the glass empty? Who can answer me? Now, some are saying empty. The glass is not empty, respected elders and brothers. The glass is full. Simple science tells us that the glass is not empty. The glass is not filled with water, it's filled with air. Do you understand? The glass is not filled with water, it's filled with air. Your child's mind, respected elders and brothers, is like a glass of water. If you don't fill your child's mind at home, it won't remain empty. The television will fill it for you, his friends at school will fill it for you, his teachers at school will fill it for you. Know and understand this. This simple science teaches us, it's common sense, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam clearly taught us. Today we find it appropriate to let our children be. Why? We are too busy chasing after the dunya. We busy ourselves to such an extent where sometimes we get both parents working so that we can make ends meet and leave our child with who? With a childminder or with a care center. And we don't realize we are losing valuable time in this child's life. Remember when building a house, the strongest thing has to be the foundation. These are the foundation years and we are leaving it. And more so, we're tiring ourselves chasing the dunya and we're becoming depressed about it. I don't want to change the topic to this as yet, but let me just mention it as a point of interest. Because it's true. Today we find the Muslim Ummah going through various troubles of depression. There's a set of tablets known as Prozac. I don't know if you've heard of them. We find many of our Muslim women, many of our Muslim families on this medication. Why? They are suffering depression. Why? Because they've made the objective the dunya. They are not happy eating from the plate which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them. They are more interested in eating from the plate that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given somebody else. So they've made that the objective. Because they don't have it, it's a means of their depression. Yet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, make Jannah the criteria. Jannah is more valuable than any amount of wealth you can acquire in this world, respected elders and brothers. And more so, Jannah is acquirable. We are able to acquire it. £1 million, we may acquire it, we may not acquire it. And because we're not acquiring it, it's a means of our depression. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, make Jannah the criteria. It's more valuable, it's more precious and better off, it's acquirable. If you make that the criteria, respected elders and brothers, is there room for us to be depressed and suffer depression? Absolutely not. So what we're doing now, at the expense of our children, we are chasing the dunya. We are letting the television fill their minds, we are letting the outside people fill their minds, and then when they are in the avenue of drugs, we are running to the ulama and asking the ulama for assistance. You as a parent, first and foremost, were responsible for the upbringing of this child. Respected elders and brothers, I may sound a bit emotional, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has entered me in this field for the past 2 years, alhamdulillah, and through my various visits throughout the country surrounding Zimbabwe, and now here in the UK, it's a sad situation. This should really be something which depresses us. We are losing our youth. We are losing them. These are our futures. The Muslim Ummah, at the moment, is engaged in drugs. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his protection. So, we have to be responsible, respected elders and brothers, in regards to upbringing these children. Know and understand, you as a father are responsible for him. Many fathers claim, my child goes to madrasa, the Mawlana is not teaching him his namaz, the Mawlana is not teaching him his Quran. Respected elders and brothers, you are your child's father. You are your child's mother, for the mothers who are listening at home. The Mawlana is not responsible for your child reading his salah. The madrasa only provides a complementary role to your role as a parent. The madrasa, listen to the statement very carefully. The madrasa only provides a complementary role to your role as a parent. You teach your child salah, the Mawlana at madrasa will just polish it for you. You teach your child good manners, the madrasa, that Mawlana at madrasa or the teacher at madrasa will polish it for you. You teach your child how to behave himself appropriately, how to be respectful, how to be constant with his salawat, how to respect his elders. All the teaching of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is upon you, O father, upon you, O mother, not the teacher at madrasa. The teacher at madrasa, his role is just complementary. It just polishes your role. Know and understand that your child only sits with the teacher at madrasa for 2 hours a day. And even with that, the teacher at madrasa has maybe 12, 13 kids around it. Majority of the day, yes, the child may be at school, but majority of his life, from the age when he was born till 6 before he went to school, he was in your home underneath your care. So respected elders and brothers, let us take this advice in regards to bringing up our children and take this invitation to solid and sound Islamic principles in nurturing our kids. The second aspect I want to discuss is that between husbands and wives. Know and understand, respected elders and brothers, that again Islam in this avenue hasn't left anything untaught to us. Hasn't left anything untaught to us. In fact, the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in used to say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam never left one thing untaught to us. Even the aspect of us in the lavatories, in the toilets, he has taught us appropriately how to conduct ourselves. That's how complete Islam is. And in regards to our wives, and wives to their husbands, Islam teaches us that as well. Today we find people, husbands, the males. Today I'm going to concentrate on the males. Someone might say that the speaker today might be a feminist. But we're going to concentrate on the males. Why? Because I have you people in front of me. We find fathers who are stuck in traffic on a hot day. It's the summertime. Traffic is delaying him. He's probably hungry. He comes home finally. He finds the children screaming up in a mess, he sits down on the table, has his meal, and the meal has 2 teaspoons less salt in it. So what does he do? He starts venting his frustrations of the whole day on his spouse. On who? On the one that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you stay with her to take peace from. You stay with her to take peace from. Respected elders and brothers, you will be questioned on the day of Qiyamah in regards to your dealing with your spouses. Wife bashing is totally forbidden in Islam. Today we find husbands who are bashing their wives. Although in some homes, the wives respond by sending the frying pans to them. But we find husbands engaging in this, respected elders and brothers. And we find men who have the un-Islamic belief and behavior that women are meant to be astray because they're created from the bent rib of Adam. And this is not true. And why I'm mentioning this here, because throughout my practice in this field, I've heard the statement more than 5 times. That a woman is a woman, she's made from the bent rib. Respected elders and brothers, she's not made from the bent rib. She's made from the curved, delicate rib of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. Not the bent rib, the curved, delicate rib of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. Just as you see the new moon, beautifully curved and shaped, she is made from the beautiful curved and delicate rib of Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. If you try and straighten her, it will break. But what does that mean? That means you, as a husband, as a support over her, respected elders and brothers, should be supportive of her. Yes, they go through monthly periods, they go through different emotional periods, etc. You are straight, so you must handle it. If you can't handle it, then you are bent. If you can't handle it, then you are bent. So respected elders and brothers, inshallah, all of us from amongst the good husbands, inshallah. But those who are listening at home, and inshallah, it's your duty, as I said, بَلِّغُوا عَنِّي وَلَوْ آيَا. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam taught us that teach someone something from me, even if it's one ayah. You have a responsibility to go and teach your fellow friends. And as parents also, respected elders and brothers, teach your children how to be good husbands. Today people get married and they didn't marry a wife, they just made their friends more closer. When you get married, teach your children, and this is for the youth who are here, respected elders and brothers, your friends go back. Your first friend is your wife. The person you take peace from is your wife. She comes first. Today, we find the youth getting married and they continue as if they're not married, and 6 months down the line, there's major problems which we have to deal with, and the parents come running to the ulama and they expect the ulama to solve a problem, and yet everything boils down to poor upbringing in the homes. That's what it is. We didn't bring them up properly, we didn't educate them Islamically properly, and then we didn't even take time as a father to sit down with them before they got married and advise them. Ad-deenu nasiha. advise them how to conduct themselves appropriately. So I leave you this responsibility, respected elders and brothers. I know I've taken much of your time, but alhamdulillah, we haven't seen anyone yawning. My policy is if somebody yawns, I stop the lecture. So nobody has yawned, alhamdulillah. The next advice for this evening, which I invite one and all to, is salah. And I have to speak about salah because after tawheed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made salah a criteria. Respected elders and brothers, the aspect of the ummah in regards to their salawat, especially our youth, brings tears to one's eye. Brings tears to one's eye. And it distresses one's heart. We find our youth again in distress because they are not upon their salah. Is not salah the one thing that Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal says puts an end to all immoral behavior and all those things that are disliked to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Inna salata tanha anil fahsha'i wal munkar. This is the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That salah puts an end. I've told I have 2 minutes. Salah puts an end to all immoral behavior and all that dislike to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I was going to speak further on salah, but because we have 2 minutes, I'll have to cut it short. Don't we have 10 minutes, Father? 10, okay. Adhan will be at 10:40, so we'll cut it short. Respected elders and brothers, the aspect of salah, it's a big topic. I was hoping to have at least 10 minutes on it, but I have 1 minute. Please make sure that we do encourage our youth to salah. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam has taught us that at the age of 7, start your children making salah. At the age of 10, punish them a little bit if they don't make their salah. And don't start punishing your children at the age of 7, because this is the hikmah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you start beating them at the age of 7, then they'll start hating salah. So start them properly at 7, at the age of 10 punish them a little bit and make sure they live their lives inshaAllah without missing one salah. If they don't, then it will help us by itself, cutting out the chances of us losing our youth to all the different faculties of life, all the evils. Respected elders and brothers, ending off, I don't want you to be gloomy, I don't want you to be upset. I did speak on some hot topics, some topics that we might find in our own homes. You are living, you are alive, Allah has given you breath. Each breath that you are breathing, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking you to turn back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah will forgive every sin. Every sin after shirk, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive. If you haven't done salah, if you haven't done zakah, if you have failed miserably in bringing up your children, if your children are lost in the avenues of the kuffar, know and understand that everything you have done, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed you by being here to hear this talk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you. I leave you with the ayah of hope. Allah Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِن رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, tell them, O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, tell all my servants, all my slaves, all those who have lived their lives in misguidance, all those who have lived their lives in my disobedience, don't lose hope. Hope in the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive your sins wholesale, quicker than the blink of an eye. إِنَّهُ هُوَ الْغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Indeed, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most forgiving, the most merciful. Alhamdulillah, we see some smiles on the faces of the brothers now. Keep on smiling. Allah has blessed you with Islam and He has blessed you with life. Turn to Allah now. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَقْبَلُ التَّوْبَةَ الْعَبْدِ مَالَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepts the plea for forgiveness of his slave as long as he hasn't touched death. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us Jannah. May He grant us graves which are gardens from the gardens of Jannah. May He grant us shade under His arsh on Qiyamah. And may He grant us Jannah with Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Wa sallallahu wa sallam wa baraka ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi ajma'in. Hmm.